Good morning once again to all of you. Today, as I told you, we are going to start with the second unit of the molecular biology, where we are going to study about DNA replication. Before going to the details of replication in prokaryotes and eukaryotes, in this class, we are going to discuss about the overview of DNA replication. So basically here, we are going to discuss about different modes of DNA replication and also few terms which we often come across while studying the replication. So first, let's discuss about semi-conservative replication. What is the semi-conservative replication? The key fact on which the mechanism of DNA replication that relies on is, we all know that the DNA double helical structure, it has two strands of DNA. Both these strands of DNA, they carry the same genetic information, which means, in other words, both the strands are complementary to each other in terms of their sequence. So this is the fact on which the mechanism of DNA replication relies on. This point we also discussed when we were discussing about DNA structure. So during replication, what happens? Both these strands of DNA, they separate, and each separated strand that acts as template and it directs the synthesis of new strand of DNA. So at the end of one round of DNA replication, you will have two double-stranded DNA molecules which will be passed on to the daughter cells during the cell division. And here, I was mentioning that there will be the separation of both the strands of DNA during the process of replication. So the point, the position at which the separation of strands takes place, and that's the point where the synthesis of new DNA takes place. So the point at which the separation of strands and then the synthesis of new DNA takes place, that's known as replication fork. And the semi-conservative mechanism of DNA replication that was demonstrated by an experiment conducted by Messelsel and Stahl in the year 1958. So what they have done in this experiment, what are the details? Let's check. So this diagram shows the results of this Messelsel-Stahl experiment. What they have done is they have taken E. coli cells, and for several generations, these E. coli cells were grown in the medium containing the heavy isotope of nitrogen. We all know the nitrogen is N14. The normal nitrogen is N14. Its heavy isotope is N15. So in this experiment, what these two scientists have done is that the E. coli cells were grown in the medium containing the N15 isotope of nitrogen for several generations. So when it is done, what happens? The entire nitrogen, which is N14 otherwise, is replaced by N15. That means both the strands of DNA will have the N15 isotope of nitrogen. Okay, so after the entire nitrogen is replaced by N15 in both the strands of DNA, which means after several generations of growth in that medium, then the E. coli cells were transferred into the medium containing the normal nitrogen, that is N14. And after it is transferred to the medium containing normal nitrogen, after every cell generation, that means after every cell division, the cells were taken, the DNA was prepared, and it was analyzed on the cesium chloride gradient. So the cesium chloride gradient, the technique which was used was equilibrium. The cesium chloride gradient separation was used. This is the technique which separates the DNA based on the differences in their buoyant density. So after every generation, the cells were taken from the culture, and DNA was prepared and it was analyzed on cesium chloride gradient centrifugation. So here, these are the test tubes shown, and here it is shown the DNA band, the position where it forms the band before it is transferred to the normal medium containing N14. That means when the DNA, when the E. coli cells were grown for several generations in the medium containing N15 isotope, when the DNA was analyzed in the test tube, this is the position where the DNA band is formed. And here, both the strands of DNA, they consist of the heavy isotope of nitrogen. This dark line that indicates the DNA strand containing the heavy isotope of nitrogen. So here, both the strands are having the heavy isotope of nitrogen. So here, after the first generation, when the cells are transferred to the medium containing the light isotope of nitrogen, which means N14. So here, what happens after the first cell division, all the DNA that consists of hybrid density, which means that one strand is having the heavy isotope, whereas the other strand is having the light isotope. So the entire DNA is of hybrid density. So the position of the band is halfway between the gradient positions of fully heavy isotope and fully light isotope. So this is the position. This is the position of the DNA where both the strands are having the heavy isotope. And this is the position of the DNA where both the strands are having the N14 nitrogen. So here, after the first cell generation, when you isolate the DNA on cesium chloride gradient, the band is formed halfway between the positions of fully labeled and fully unlabeled. This is the halfway between, which means that the entire DNA is of hybrid density. One strand is having the N15, the other strand is having the N14. And after the second generation, when you analyze the DNA, 50% of DNA was found to be of hybrid density, whereas the 50% of DNA is of light density. That means 50% of DNA, both the strands have N14 nitrogen, and whereas 50% of DNA has got, one strand heavy isotope, the other strand is light isotope. So you have one band here where it shows the hybrid density and one band which shows the light density. That means the unlabeled DNA. And after the next generation, third generation, what happened? There is increase in the proportion of light DNA, but of course there is the hybrid density DNA present. So if you look at the pattern of the results, first both the strands were of heavy density, because the cells were grown for several generations in the medium containing the N15 nitrogen. When they are transferred to the medium containing N14, after the first cell division, the entire DNA was of hybrid density. That's why it shows the position halfway between the positions of fully labeled, that means high density, and the fully unlabeled, which means the light density. Then after every subsequent generation, there is increase in the proportion of the light DNA, but still there is existence of some hybrid density DNA. So this kind of results, this kind of pattern of results are possible if the mechanism of DNA replication is by semi-conservative mechanism. Why is it called semi-conservative mechanism? When the DNA is synthesized after every cycle of replication, one strand is from the parental origin, whereas the one strand is newly synthesized. That's why it is called semi-conservative mechanism of replication. So here it is shown, the replication fork position is shown. As I told you, replication fork is the point at which both the strands of the DNA are separated, and at the same time there is the initiation of new DNA synthesis takes place. So that point is called replication fork. I hope you are able to follow. Any confusion here?
No ma'am.
Okay, we'll proceed. So here it is shown, the heavy isotope is N15, and then after several cell generations, it is transferred into the medium containing N14, then analyzed on cesium chloride density gradient centrifugation technique, which separates the DNA molecule based on the differences in buoyant density. So the results, whatever I have explained with the previous slide, that kind of pattern of results only can be interpreted in case of semi-conservative mode of DNA replication. So all the DNA molecules, they replicate in this fashion. So here, as I mentioned before explaining this experiment, both the strands are separated and each strand, it acts as template. So the template strand that is read in 3 prime to 5 prime direction and the new DNA is synthesized in 5 prime to 3 prime direction. Always the DNA replication, that means the synthesis of DNA takes place always in 5 prime to 3 prime direction, whereas the template is read in 3 prime to 5 prime direction. And when there is a synthesis of DNA, we require the presence of precursors or substrates which are required for DNA synthesis. So we have four different precursors or substrates which are involved in DNA synthesis. And these precursors are, in general, they are called as deoxynucleoside triphosphates. And for four different bases, we have four different types of substrates available, DATP, DGTP, DCTP, and DTTP. So here the reaction mechanism that involves the nucleophilic attack of the 3 prime hydroxyl group of the nucleotide, and where it attacks at the 3 prime end of the growing strand at the alpha phosphorus of the DNTP, which is complementary to the next template base. And here, when this nucleotide is incorporated to the growing chain of nucleic acid, what happens? There is elimination of pyrophosphate. So that is why, though the substrate is triphosphate, when the polymerization is taking place during the synthesis of DNA, only one phosphate per nucleotide that gets incorporated in the nucleic acid chain, whereas the other two phosphates are released or eliminated in the form of pyrophosphate. The energy which is required for polymerization that comes from the hydrolysis of these DNTPs and, of course, the resulting pyrophosphate. So the energy which is required for the polymerization that comes from the hydrolysis of these nucleotides, which are deoxynucleoside triphosphates and the resultant pyrophosphate. So that's about semi-conservative mode of replication. We need to explain by that experiment and the neat diagram. Then, as I told you in the beginning of class, let's also discuss about some terminology which we often come across while studying the replication. So the terms what we are going to discuss are replicons, origins, and termini. So what is replicon? Any piece of DNA which replicates as a single unit is called a replicon. Any piece of DNA which replicates as a single unit is called replicon. And within this replicon, the initiation of DNA replication always, it occurs at a fixed point. Replicon is a piece of DNA which replicates as a single unit. And within this replicon, always the initiation of DNA synthesis that occurs at a fixed point, not like anywhere randomly, always it occurs at a fixed point, and that is known as origin of replication. And during this process of replication, especially in case of circular DNA, usually two replication forks, they proceed bidirectionally away from the origin, and the strands are copied as they are separated, and the copying or the the replication that is continued until the terminus site is reached. So two replication forks always they proceed bidirectionally away from the origin, and the strands are copied. Each strand that acts as template, right? So the strands are copied as they separate until the terminus is reached. As I told you, all prokaryotic chromosomes and many bacteriophages and many viruses, they contain DNA in the form of circular molecule. So these all the DNA which is present in all these different type of organisms is circular in nature and it exists as a single replicon. The circular DNA, it exists as a single replicon. So when there is only single replicon, obviously there will be one origin of replication, and to the origin of replication, roughly 180 degree opposite position, you will see the presence of termination site. So this diagram shows the bidirectional replication of a circular bacterial replicon. All the prokaryotes and many bacteriophages and viruses, they contain DNA in the form of circular molecule. And when it is a circular molecule, it is organized as a single replicon. So this is origin of replication, and roughly 180 degree opposite to the origin position, there is terminus. So two replication forks, they proceed away from each other bidirectionally, and the strands are copied as they are separated until the terminus site is reached. So when the terminus site is reached, the copying of the strands is complete, and you will have the formation of two complete circular molecules. So as you say, the dark lines that indicate the newly synthesized DNA, whereas the light line is the parental strand of DNA. So they get attached to each other. Later they will be unlinked by the activity of certain specific enzymes. All those details we'll study more in detail when we study the various steps involved in the prokaryotic DNA replication. So here only the point what you need to understand is, in case of the prokaryotic DNA, where the DNA is in the form of circular DNA, there is only, it is organized as single replicon consisting of one origin of replication, and at 180 degree position, you will have the terminus. Two replication forks, they proceed bidirectionally away from each other, and they are copied as the strands are separated till the terminus is reached. Two molecules are synthesized, and these two molecules, two double-stranded circular DNA molecules formed, will be passed on to the two daughter cells during the process of cell division. So far we have studied two different modes of DNA replication. One is semi-conservative, the other one is bidirectional replication, which we see in case of the circular DNA. But in case of long linear DNA molecules, these long linear DNA molecules are seen in case of the eukaryotes. In eukaryotes, the DNA is present as long linear DNA molecules, and this is organized in the form of multiple replicons. The entire DNA is organized as several replicons, and each replicon contains its own origin of replication. So these are all, these dark points are the origins of replications for each replicon. But all these replicons, they are replicated simultaneously. So when they are replicated simultaneously, you see them in the form of bubbles, and these are called replication bubbles. So as the replication forks progress, when the adjacent bubbles meet, they get fused. They get fused. The adjacent bubbles get fused, and there will be formation of the two complete strands of DNA. So here the point is that in case of the long linear DNA molecules, which occur in case of the eukaryotes, that is organized in the form of multiple replicons. Each replicon has its own origin of replication, and all these replicons, they replicate simultaneously. When they are replicating simultaneously, it appears like bubbles. These are called replication bubbles. When the adjacent bubbles meet because of the progression of replication forks or the progression of replication, they get fused, and there will be the synthesis of two strands of DNA at the end of one round of replication. So if you take the mammalian cell as an example, a typical mammalian cell, it consists of about 50,000 to 1 lakh replicons, with a size of each replicon size is about 40 to 200 kb. So here, where the replication forks from adjacent replication bubbles, when they meet, they fuse to form the completely replicated DNA as it was shown in the previous diagram. So the sequences of this eukaryotic chromosomal origins are simpler. I'm talking about the complexity of the origin sequence. So prokaryotic origins are comparatively more complex in nature, whereas in case of the eukaryotic origins, they are comparatively simpler. And whether it is prokaryotic origins or eukaryotic origins, all these origin sequences, they contain AT-rich sequences. Why? Because, as you all know, AT-rich sequences are comparatively easier to open than GC-rich sequences. Tell me why. Why AT-rich sequences are easier to open up than GC-rich sequences?
Because of two hydrogen bonds.
Exactly. So here the point is origins are AT-rich because it is easy to open up. As you said, there are only two hydrogen bonds involved in base pairing of this AT bases. All right. So that's about replicon and origin, what we understood. Next, another mode of replication, that is semi-discontinuous replication. What is this semi-discontinuous replication? The earlier mechanism what we studied was semi-conservative mechanism of DNA replication. There what happens, always the DNA synthesis takes place in 5 prime to 3 prime direction. And in the DNA, as we all know, there are two strands, and both these strands, they are anti-parallel to each other. If one strand runs in 5 prime to 3 prime direction, the other strand runs in 3 prime to 5 prime direction. So the template which reads in 5 prime to 3 prime direction, there the DNA synthesis will take place in 5 prime to 3 prime direction, which is allowed. But how about the other strand which runs in 5 prime to 3 prime direction? There it appears that the DNA synthesis takes place in 3 prime to 5 prime direction, which cannot happen. Do you understand what I'm saying? There are two strands in DNA, both are anti-parallel to each other. And always the DNA synthesis can take place in 5 prime to 3 prime direction. This is all right in case of the strand or the template that runs in 3 prime to 5 prime direction. Obviously, the DNA synthesis will take place in 5 prime to 3 prime direction. How about the strand or the template that runs in 5 prime to 3 prime direction? There, the DNA synthesis cannot take place in 3 prime to 5 prime direction, right? So in order to understand how is it happening, they have also conducted another experiment by taking the E. coli cells. So in this experiment, what they have done is, the E. coli cells are labeled just for few seconds with the tritium-labeled thymidine. This tritium-labeled thymidine is a radioactive precursor of DNA. So when this tritium-labeled thymidine is labeled, and when the cells are incubated just for few seconds, and then the DNA was analyzed on alkaline sucrose gradient, this is the technique which separates the single-stranded DNA, single-stranded denatured DNA according to their sizes. So when this was analyzed on this alkaline sucrose gradient, it was found that a large fraction of the newly synthesized DNA in the form of small fragments. I hope you are able to follow what I'm saying. In this experiment, what was done was E. coli cells are incubated just for few seconds with the tritium-labeled thymidine, which is a radioactive precursor. Then after that few seconds, when the DNA was analyzed on the sucrose gradient, a large fraction of the newly synthesized DNA was found to be in the form of small fragments. Fragments of length 1000 to 2000 nucleotide long in case of prokaryotes. And in case of eukaryotes, the length of the fragments was found to be 100 to 200 nucleotides. And then later, when these cells were incubated further with unlabeled thymidine. So here they have used tritium-labeled thymidine Then later further, the cells were incubated with unlabeled thymidine. After this incubation, it was found that all these small fragments which were found in the previous stir, they found to be rapidly joined to form the high molecular weight DNA, which means that all these small fragments which were found in the previous stir, they've all joined together to form the long DNA molecule. Later, these small fragments were called as Okazaki fragments. These results can be explained by semi-discontinuous replication model. This kind of results, what kind of results? In the beginning, when you analyze the DNA, the newly synthesized DNA was found to be in the form of short fragments. And later, when you allow the further synthesis to take place, all these fragments are joined together to form the continuous DNA. So these kind of results can be explained by a semi-discontinuous replication model. What is this semi-discontinuous replication model? One strand, which is called leading strand, is synthesized as a long continuous molecule. That is, in case of the template, which runs in 3' to 5' direction, the leading strand synthesis takes place in 5' to 3' direction as a continuous replication. There are no gaps, no short fragments, like a long continuous molecule, it is synthesized. This is called leading strand. And the another strand will not be synthesized immediately, but it just gets displaced for a short distance. And the distance is about 1000 to 2000 nucleotide long in case of prokaryotes. And it is further short for about 100 to 200 nucleotide long in case of the eukaryotes. And then the DNA synthesis takes place towards the origin in 5' to 3' direction. The DNA replication takes place in the reverse direction towards the origin in 5' to 3' direction. So always the DNA synthesis takes place in 5' to 3' direction only. So likewise, as the replication fork progresses, several such short fragments in 5' to 3' direction will be synthesized. So here one molecule is shown, and the short fragment which is synthesized is called Okazaki fragment. As the replication progresses further, second fragment, many such fragments will be synthesized. After several such fragments are synthesized, later all these fragments are joined together, and finally the seals are joined by DNA ligase enzyme. So this is called semi-discontinuous mechanism. Why is it semi-discontinuous mechanism? One strand is synthesized continuously, which is leading strand, whereas the other strand is synthesized discontinuously, which is the lagging strand. All these discontinuous fragments will be joined later to form a long linear DNA molecule. That is why this mechanism of DNA replication is called semi-discontinuous replication. And this mode of replication is also called as asymmetric replication. Why is it asymmetric replication? One strand is synthesized continuously, whereas the other strand is synthesized discontinuously by synthesizing several short fragments. That's why it is called asymmetric replication also. Many times in the exams, they will also ask you, explain the mechanism of asymmetric DNA replication. In your syllabus also, it is mentioned as asymmetric DNA replication. So don't get confused. This semi-discontinuous or asymmetric replications are one or the other same. Is it clear, the semi-discontinuous replication? Any questions so far?
No.
Okay. Am I clear to you, the voice?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Because when you speak, there is breakage in the voice. So I got a doubt. Am I audible to you in the same way, or is it clear? Okay. If it is clear, one more small point to be completed. RNA priming. What is this RNA priming? See, as we discussed, whether it is a leading strand or lagging strand, in lagging strand synthesis, there are several short fragments. when you closely observe these DNA fragments that are synthesized, at the 5 prime end, you do not see the deoxyribonucleotides, rather you see ribonucleotides. Only at the 5 prime, few nucleotides are ribonucleotides, they are not deoxyribonucleotides. This is because every time the DNA synthesis is primed by a short fragment of RNA, that means the DNA synthesis is primed by RNA. And all these RNA primers, if it is a leading strand, there will be only one segment of RNA at the 5 prime end. If it is a lagging strand, several fragments are there. Every fragment at the 5 prime end, you have the few ribonucleotides. So all these RNA primers, they are removed. When these primers are removed, there will be the formation of gaps. All these gaps that are formed because of the removal of these RNA primers, they're all filled with DNA before the fragments are joined. So all these Okazaki fragments, when you observe them closely, at the 5 prime end, you have few ribonucleotides. That is because every time the DNA synthesis is primed by RNA. So after all these Okazaki fragments are synthesized, all these RNA primers are removed. When they are removed, there will be the gaps formed. And the gaps formed are filled with DNA. So during this filling process, there is involvement of enzymes like DNA polymerase N, DNA polymerase 1, DNA ligase. All that mechanism we will see more in detail later. But here, just to understand that always the DNA synthesis is primed by RNA, and these RNA primers are later removed, and the gaps created by this primer removal, they'll be filled with DNA before the fragments are joined. So why this DNA synthesis is always RNA primed, that is basically in order to maintain the high fidelity of DNA replication. This is one of the mechanisms by which the DNA replication fidelity is maintained. That means the correctness, the incorporation of wrong bases can be avoided. So in order to maintain the fidelity of replication, the RNA priming takes place during the synthesis of DNA. So this is all I wanted to discuss in today's class in overview of DNA replication. So just to summarize quickly, we have discussed different modes of DNA replication, like, you know, semi-conservative replication, which was demonstrated by Meselson and Stahl experiment. Later, we also discussed about the bidirectional DNA replication, which occurs in case of circular DNA. Later, we also discussed semi-discontinuous mode of DNA replication. This is also called as asymmetric replication, where one strand is synthesized as a continuous molecule, whereas the other strand is synthesized discontinuously, forming several short fragments of DNA. These several short fragments are called Okazaki fragments. In addition, we also looked at the meaning of different terms, like what is replicon, what is replication fork, what is origin, what is terminus. These are all the different terms. We tried to understand the meaning. Then also, at last, we looked at what is RNA priming. RNA priming is every time the DNA synthesis is primed by a short fragment of RNA. This is done in order to maintain the high fidelity of DNA replication. Any questions? In next class, we'll discuss about prokaryotic DNA replication. If there are